So I've had some viewers write in and ask questions about what they should do to their Mustang, Falcon, Fairlane, Maverick suspension on the front of the car. Actually, they just asked about the Fairlane because, you know, people typically don't write in and ask. In any case, after the break, you and I are going to sit down and talk about Fairlane, Falcon, Mustang, Maverick suspension, and Torino. But they're kind of the same car. So, you know?
Autocrafters, your source for Falcon, Fairlane, Full Size, Mustang, Maverick, Pinto, Ford Truck, Cougar. Contact us at www.autocrafters.com.
All right, so what did Ford put on their midsize to small cars from 1960 all the way up to basically 78? That was the SLA front suspension. It was a short, long arm suspension with a coil over design. In other words, the coil was up on top of the upper control arm. And what I want to talk to you about today is what you can do to make that a better performing suspension without spending a huge amount of money. It's amazing the differences that can be made with just a few small changes to the SLA Ford suspension. So what we're going to be talking about is those changes. But first, I want to go over just a little bit of theory with you. So what is that theory? Always build your car for your 90%. Never build a car on what you think you're going to do twice a year. And a lot of guys do. There's a lot of guys that build their car on their 10%, not their 90%. I would rather have a car that I'm extremely happy with 90% of the time than a car that I'm going to just enjoy the piss out of twice a year. Because when you're driving it the rest of the time, it's gonna suck. You're gonna bitch about the ride quality, you're gonna bitch about how it runs, or whatever you do to it. Always look at what you plan to do with the car 90% of the time. Build to that with a few extras added in from the 10%, and you're going to be a lot happier with what you're running down the road. So remember that. Build to your 90%. Don't build for the 10%. 10% makes you grumpy. Trust me, I know. I have built cars to that 10%. Not a great idea. So now that we know what we're going to build and how we're going to do it, what I'm going to start talking about is some of the things that you can do to actually make your car a 90% car rather than a 10% car. All right, first off, some things you might not know. One of those is that these suspensions on these cars were not designed for gas shocks. Frankly, gas shocks are not a great idea on these cars if you're staying with the stock original suspension, because the gas shocks actually add spring rate to your front suspension. So if you put a set of 720 coils on your car, which is one of those that a lot of guys talk about, your shocks are actually going to add spring rate to that if they are gas shocks. The two places I know that you can get a fairly decent non-gas shock is QA1 and Viking. Both of them sell non-gas shocks in a variety of applications. They even have applications now for the station wagon. Just look for it under Ranchero, because they're the same. So whenever you're doing this, look to a hydraulic shock to put on the car. If you put a gas shock on here, it will raise the car a little bit and it will also ride a lot more rough than it would with a classic hydraulic shock like these cars originally came with. When we took the gas shocks off the 69 Fairlane, the nose on this sucker dropped about a half an inch. So one way to quickly lower your car could be to take those gas shocks off, put a set of QA1s or Vikings on there, and Viola, you may have a lower car right off the bat without doing anything but changing out your shocks. Now, Ford on the SLA front suspensions on these old cars did not put caster into them. Most of the time your caster is going to be zero unless you're running power steering, and sometimes I believe they added a little bit of caster for that. But what you're really wanting for performance applications is 2 to 3 degrees of positive caster on the front end. You're not going to get that from most alignment shops, but I'm going to go into that in just a little bit. Now, bigger isn't always better on your springs either, and that's another thing that's always kind of been a pet peeve of mine, is I'll hear guys say that I put the 720 pound coils on my car. No, you didn't. You just didn't. It is actually a 720 spring. It is actually a 720 wire. That's what you've put on there. It's a larger wire with a lot more spring rate, and honestly, you probably don't even need it. Most of the time, for average applications, when you're street driving, that 720 spring is going to pound you to death on the road, especially if you go in and couple that sucker with some gas shocks. It'll ride like a buckboard. You'd do better to call somebody like Eaton Detroit Spring and say, hey, I want a performance spring for my car. They're going to upgrade you to the GT springs, and you'll want to go ahead and get, guess what, the hydraulic shocks rather than the gas. You will have a nice handling and a nice riding car that you can adjust the shocks out to kind of beef it up if you want to go out and really push the car around the corners hard. Me, I set mine at about a 5 on this one with the stock springs on it that, unfortunately, Steve's brother kind of, he cut a coil off of them. And I'm not great on cutting coils. I don't much care for it. But in any case, with a cut coil, my front end is now so low that I can't even get a bloody jack underneath the front of this Fairlane wagon. Now, another thing I wanted to talk about is the fact that there is a problem with wanting to put too much hard into your car. I know hard is good, right? I mean, we like that, you know, hardwood, you know, metal is hard, I get it. But the problem is when you start putting a real high Deuteronomy rubber or a real high, like a polyurethane into your suspension, like your springs and things like that, the more polyurethane you add, the harsher the ride is gonna be. It's gonna really rely more on the rear suspension being that being the case, but on the front suspension, it can be a problem too. Now, I agree with putting urethane bushings on your sway bars to a degree, but it can also, again, cause you a little bit of issues because the more urethane you add, the more road noise and everything you're feeding into the chassis. So just remember that when you're setting all this stuff up. Now, to the meat and potatoes of what we're going to be doing here. Things that work on stock suspensions to make them handle and run a lot better. It is really amazing to me that so many people will dump out their stock suspension in favor of an aftermarket suspension when they may not want to in the reality of things. In other words, I think that there is an absolute place for an aftermarket suspension. Cam's Mustang is a perfect example of that. We put a street or track system underneath that car. The way I see him drive, he will actually probably do better having that, because the guy's a bit of a nut behind the wheel. But a lot of us don't necessarily need them. If you're going to be driving your car and your 90% is going to be just cruising around your area, going to the car shows, all that is candy that you may not want to eat because it's pretty expensive. But I'm going to give you some things that you can put on there that will make a difference with your stock suspension. Now, the first of those is this, and that is roller spring perches. I poo-pooed the roller spring perches for a long time personally because I was like, I can't make that big of a difference. I mean, the spring perch is the spring perch, right? It's just holding the spring. But I'm telling you right now, the roller spring perch on this Fairlane made a difference in the ride quality and the handling of the car. Ford originally designed the SLA suspension on the Falcon to run a roller spring perch. And they didn't go with it because it was just too expensive to do on those cars. Thus, when they moved on to all the different chassis, they stayed with the rubber isolated spring perch, and voila, you have a car that doesn't handle quite as well because of the reaction of the spring. Now, I've already mentioned the QA1s and the Viking shocks, but if you're going to improve the ride and handling of your classic Ford, go with something like those shocks. As long as it is a hydraulic and not a gas shock, you will be a lot happier with the ride quality and even the handling. These cars were designed to run a hydraulic shock, so a QA1 or a Viking shock will go a long way to making the car handle much more like it did in a positive way than you might think. Plus, like I said, your ride quality will improve exponentially because you're not adding spring rate into your front coils. And if you went with those 720 pound coils, the QA1s or the Vikings will do a lot for making that ride quality just a little bit better. Now, another thing that you can do, we've done a video on this, is shim the front of the upper control arm. And that is to go in and get a little bit longer bolt, put 3/8 inches of shims between the shock tower and the control arm on the very front bolt on your control arms, and then that way you will get a caster change on the front end. This makes a big difference in the way the car drives and handles because you're putting that caster in that I'm talking about you needing. And it's a permanent installation of caster. Now, the one thing I will tell you they're going to have to watch out for is alignment shops. Most of them are kind of lazy. They don't want to do a lot of extra work. If they have the really cool, modern, automated machines, if they happen to have a classic car in the programming, which a lot of times is kind of unlikely, if they have that programming in there, it's going to set you to a stock alignment on the front end. So in other words, what you'll want to be able to do is go to the guy and say, can you put a custom alignment set in here? Now I'm going to put something in the description below for the alignment specs that we use on our Fairlane and on any classic car that we put together around here using the techniques that I've talked about already. So there will be something in the description on that below. But trust me, you want to have about 2 to 3 degrees of caster, 1/16 inch of toe, and you should be good to go. You should have everything you need then to get a good running car that's going to track well and go down the road. You may need to go to a 1/8 inch of toe, but if you're doing that, you probably need to look to your steering components in the car and check on those and make sure they're still in good nick. Always, always, when you're doing suspension, go ahead and check out the steering stuff because I'm telling you right now, if the suspension is worn out, look at the steering stuff because it may be worn out as well. Idler arms and pitman arms and tie rod ends and drag links, all that stuff needs to be checked for proper operation and safety along with the steering box itself because they get worn out. If you have a Fairlane, that last one, she's going to be a problem. Now, I'm going to talk a little bit about sway bars and say what you should try to do is to do probably a 1-inch front sway bar and a 3/4-inch rear sway bar, which is a problem on these cars because honestly, all that's really available out there in the aftermarket is a 1 1/8-inch bar and a 3/4 bar for the rear. I personally, this is just me, think that the 1/8 1/8 is a little bit too big and the 3/4 is a little bit too big. I prefer seeing a smaller rear sway bar and a smaller front bar for the Fairlane, mostly because the 1969 on back to 66 Fairlanes have a really flimsy sway bar mount. They did not anticipate people putting big ass sway bars on these classic Fords. They thought that they were just going to be tiny little sway bars and everything was going to be dainty and fine. Even their GT bar from Ford was only 7/8 of an inch in diameter. So it's not a really big bar. And when you go to a 1 1/8-inch bar, you're going to have a lot of torsional twist on those sway bar mounts, and you will, if you drive it as hard as I do, pop a sway bar mount. Ask me how I know. So when you're doing that, you may end up having to do what we've done to this car and going in and putting in the 1970 Mustang sway bar mounts. Those mounts are beefier and they're bigger. They are a pseudo close match to these. We did a video on doing the sway bar mounts. Put the link down here below me and in the description below so you can check that out if you want to see what we did to modify the 69 Fairlane so we could run that big old front sway bar. Now what I'm going to finally talk about is making sure that the front end on your car is in really good condition. Any blowholes that people have put in the shock tower so that they could grease the upper control arm bushings is bad juju because it's just weakening that shock tower. You can still have shock tower cracking around the bolts, especially in big block cars. It's why in 1968, Ford went to a beefier bracing support system on the big block Mustangs and even some of that stuff for the Fairlanes. The Fairlanes are actually a little better because of how the structure of the chassis is done with some bracing underneath the apron areas and all, but always check and make sure that stuff is in good nick because if it's not fixed, you're going to experience problems with the handling because it's going to flex and fly around a lot and the car is going to feel very loose, mostly because the chassis is jacked up. So always check those kind of things on your car. If you have blowholes, either if you're capable of doing the weld up yourself, repair those holes, close them up, check the shock towers around the bolts to make sure that those are in good shape. If you hear any ticking, as it were, like a popping noise when you go around a corner and you know all the front end components are in good shape, you may want to look to your chassis. It may be a problem around those shock towers that's causing that popping noise to happen. So in other words, you may have a shock tower bolt hole that's breaking free a little bit when it's being put under stress and load and popping that, or making the metal pop like that. Safety is number one when you're doing this kind of stuff. Now, a final word from me on this. Do me a favor, put stuff down in the description below. I did not go into aftermarket suspension components on this because it's a can of worms within itself, and I would rather separate that from this. So probably if you guys are interested, next week we will be going into the suspension components from the aftermarket and talking about the things that are offered. I'm not going to say that there are any pros and cons. There are things that I personally like better than others, but I think all of them have good merit. All of them have been around for an age, and we can go into the things that are positives and not necessarily negatives, but other things to consider when you are doing one of those type of suspensions. So put a comment in the section below. Let us know what you think about this. Give us a thumbs up or a thumbs down. Please subscribe. We're on a campaign to get to 100,000 subscribers by December 31st. You can be responsible for bringing us into a new age of me having a plaque on the wall. If you look at the video we did this last week on the 60,000 subscribers, I'll put a link to that down in the description below as well, and below me right now. You can see exactly why I'm all pumped up about the plaque. It's just a thing that's personal. Finally, you guys have a great week. Stay safe, stay well. We will see you next time on Down the Road.